right. So I'm going to switch gears a little bit. So I'm going to talk about intracameral antibiotics for prophylaxis of endophthalmitis. It's a practice that's has a good head of steam in Europe, and we're a little bit slow in the United States. We'll kind of talk about the evidence for and against the prophylaxis of endophthalmitis. We'll talk about the options of prophylaxis that we have, and then really should you adopt intracameral antibiotics into your practice for prophylaxis. So unlike Dr. Mamelis, my travel slides are more local. I don't go to Singapore or Europe very often, but this was my family and I recently went to Zion National Park, and so I'll have to show you some pictures of us there. It's tough to get six people to look at the camera at once, but it was a lot of fun. So we'll talk about a case that presented while I was on retina, and then talk about the epidemiology of endophthalmitis, some of the organisms that we see, the different types of antibiotic prophylaxis, talk about the different drugs that are used. There's a little bit of literature on the cost analysis, and there's quite a bit on safety. And then we'll look at some of the bigger studies and then come to some conclusions. So we had a 56-year-old who presented with pain in the eye and blurred vision. Just this 5 days after cataract surgery, woke up, everything had gone fine in the surgery, and just had this new blurry vision and pain. She'd had her right eye done 2 weeks before her left eye. Looking back at her chart, she had received moxifloxacin just after the surgery for every 2 hours for the first day, and then she was on it 4 times a day along with Predforte and Ketorolac. Her acuity at the time of presentation was 20/50. Her pressure was okay at 20. She had, but this is post-op day number one, sorry, and trace cell and flare. No intracameral or pre-op antibiotics were used at that time, and then received one drop of gadifloxacin at the end of the case. So pretty unremarkable surgery. She looked good on post-op day one, doing well, healing well. If you look at her course, she said that 7 a.m. she just woke up and vision was bad, and she had lots of stuff floating around in her vision, so she called and came in. Her pressure was 13 with a vision of 2100 in her left eye. She had 4-plus cell, a little hypopion. She had vitreous cell. Couldn't see the fundus because of the amount of haze that was present. So the question is this endophthalmitis? Is this TAS? Is there a retained lens fragment? Is this a uveitic syndrome? Those are the types of things that you think about. Her presentation is a little bit late for TAS. When we look at the differences between TAS and endophthalmitis, TAS is this toxic anterior segment syndrome. It's acute, it's sterile, it's usually within 24 to 48 hours. Really the timing is everything. It's not an infectious process. This is just an exuberant inflammatory response to something surrounding the surgery. They usually have marked blurred vision, and the rule is really no pain, although there are some patients who present with pain. And limbus to limbus corneal edema can kind of help you with TAS versus endophthalmitis. You can have iris damage and glaucoma, but it's really marked anterior segment inflammation, which is difficult to differentiate from endophthalmitis. But TAS usually does not have a lot of inflammation in the vitreous, so a B scan can help if you can't see the fundus. These are some pictures from a book chapter that Dr. Mamelis had published recently. And you know, the top picture, you could say that's endophthalmitis or TAS. It's hard to know, but the bottom picture with limbus to limbus corneal edema is not always typical in endophthalmitis, more so in TAS. So in our patient, we felt like this was acute postoperative endophthalmitis. Her vision was better than light perception, so according to the EVS, we did an in-office tap and inject. We use a vitrector now to get a good vitreous sample in the retina clinics and then send it for gram stain and cultures. Standard injections is vancomycin, ceftazidime, and then dexamethasone here at our institution. And then we kept her on her moxifloxacin topical and then Predforte and Ketorolac, kept those going just 4 times a day, and added atropine and oral moxifloxacin. So 1995 is when EVS came out. It's been a long time ago, or almost 20 years. But it's a very important study that helped really change endophthalmitis from a surgery, automatic surgery, to an in-office procedure if the patient has LP vision or better. If their vision is LP or worse, then there's a 3-time better chance. You see the 33% of patients that achieve 20/40 versus 11% if you do a tap and inject. So there still is a role for vitrectomy in patients who have really poor vision who present with endophthalmitis. The majority of cases are gram positive, according to the EVS study, and that still is true today. So what's the epidemiology of endophthalmitis? There's a huge range in the literature, all the way down to, in some cases, even 0% in some cohorts, up to 0.345%. Some have even reported up to 1%, 1 in 100 cases in some areas. So there's an interesting review of over 3 million patients with an overall rate of 0.128%. You can see the different changes of the decades. Kind of get this low in the 90s, and then it's kind of spiked up again in 2002, 2003. A Canada study, their rates were about 0.14 to 0.15. Complications definitely increase the risk. If you have an unplanned anterior vitrectomy, your risk goes up by 10 times. And despite what you may hope or think, residents just don't increase the risk, according to a couple of studies. You can't just blame it on the resident. But again, these are rare events, and so it's very difficult to understand the differences in varying practices. But we'll kind of explore a lot of that today. We've had a couple of published studies here from the Moran Eye Center. So 1997 to 2003, our rate was about 0.19%, and that dropped to 0.05%, really around the use of topical fluoroquinolones for prophylaxis. So last 7 years, I'm not 100% sure. I don't know if anybody knows what our rate's been, but that's the published data.
Sitting about 4 to 10 pounds.
Okay. So pretty similar to that. In Erevan, they published a study that was 42,000 consecutive cases. Their rate was 0.09% over 2 years. And they have a practice where they have reusable gowns and gloves and tubing and solutions, and they steam sterilize. Significant cost savings with not a lot of increased risk in their study. So what are the possible sources of infection? So you have anything that has direct access to the surgical wounds. So you have your ocular tear film, your eyelids, the adnexa around the eye, your irrigating solutions, anything that you put into the eye, anything from Tri-Pen Blue to the BSS bottle to your cannulas that you're inserting, all the topical medications that are put in before, after, during the surgery, your surgical instruments, even IOLs, anything that goes into the eye, the surgeon's respiratory flora, the assistant's flora. You know, you get a break in a glove, you get access to skin flora, even the operating room air. I mean, there's just so many different ways to get bacteria in and around the eye during the surgery. So the EVS showed, they did an interesting portion of their study. They cultured the eyelids of patients with endophthalmitis, and 68% had indistinguishable flora on their eyelids compared to what was growing in their eye. So we know the eyelids are a big source of infections. So what organisms are involved in the acute cases? It's really these gram positives that are the most common. It's coag negative staph and staph aureus and strep. You get some gram negatives that are rare, but have poor outcomes. And then chronic cases, we had a case that when I was on retina, coag negative staph that had been going on for a few months that was finally diagnosed by a TAP. And then you have bleb associated. So lots of different types of endophthalmitis and different bacteria associated with the different types. Another interesting study they did, they just did conjunctival swabs of 200 cases after cataract surgery. This is right after cataract surgery. 80% of them had positive bacterial growth. Half of them were propionibacterium. So it's, you know, we're not always effective at getting rid of all the bacteria, even after iodine and all that we do around the surgery. One of the biggest concerns is that MRSA is on the rise. There was a series that was published where they looked back at all their cases. They had looked at their staph aureus and endophthalmitis, and there were zero cases of MRSA up to 1992. And then almost half of their cases of staph aureus infections were MRSA between 95 and 2008. The biggest problem with this bug is it's resistant to a lot of fluoroquinolones. And so you end up, vancomycin is the best thing to kill them. But kind of a scary rise in statistics, not just in eyes, but really in all of healthcare, are these resistant organisms. So our patient, grew out gram-positive bacteria. It was coag-negative staph. It was pan-sensitive. The day after she presented with endophthalmitis, we injected another dose of vancomycin directed at those gram-positive organisms to kind of help her heal. So what do we know about coag-negative staph? There's 32 known species. There's 15 that are known to be in humans. And it's about 10% of all nosocomial infections. If you look at the number of cases of bacteremia, there's a lot of cases of this just from coag-negative staph. There's catheter-related things with central lines. UTIs are really commonly caused by it. Shunts in the CNS, endocarditis. Any surgical site has the risk of this bacteria causing an infection. So in a majority of times when you're testing for infections, this is thought to be a contaminant, but it can be an organism that actually causes real infections. These are the common bacteria that fall into coag-negative staph. So staph saprophyticus is a really common urinary tract infection, and then staph epidermidis is really the main one that we see. Staph lugdunensis, something like that. It's one of the resistant ones, so they always test specifically for that when they're looking at these endophthalmitis cases. The scary thing is that they're normal skin flora, and look at the number of colony-forming units there are in just a centimeter squared of skin. I mean, there's tens to hundreds of thousands of these bacteria.
So you know, if you took the entire bacterial load of an average human body,
how much it would weigh? I don't. It's kind of gross to think about it.
Turns the entire bacterial load between our gut, skin, everywhere we have, and it's now becoming increasingly shown in fertilizer, it's over a pound.
Wow.
Huge mass. And so the thought that somehow in the process by living cleanly, it's a critical nature of what we have in our life. So you talk about if you do a biopsy in front of you, you never sterilize. But you don't even sterilize it, it's something that's likely to destroy it.
Yeah.
So we just got to understand these bacteria are ubiquitous, and they're actually the good bacteria, even though they can cause infection, like certain kinds are critical to keep the worst infected.
Right.
And it's critical for our gut. Now, a big thing they're doing is the fecal implants for people who have GI disease, because they're taking somebody else's poop, basically put it in the colon to repopulate. And with some very interesting positive results. So,
Yep, we're learning more and more.
There's a symbiosis that's critical for a lot of our health.
So if we look at coag-negative staph, the antibiotics that are good against it, penicillin is by and large the main antibiotic for coag-negative staph. But because of resistance, you know, you have fluoroquinolones and vancomycin that are used as well in cases where there's resistance to penicillins. Cephalosporins are good. There's a lot of resistance to the macrolides, clindamycin, erythromycin, all those other different antibiotics.
So real fast, what you got is moxifloxacin is better than cefiflox.
No, better than cipro. Not Bessie, sorry. Okay. It's just better than ciprofloxacin. So there's different generations of the quinolones, and the newest one is Bessiefloxacin, but ciprofloxacin was one of the first or second generations. It's not as good as moxie. Another slide. I just forgot the name of this. Weeping Rock. It's like a straight-up trail, just a half mile. It's beautiful. There's no water running off the mountain, but it's still just, it's porous rocks just kind of leak water all year round. So what do we do to reduce the risk of endophthalmitis? So we use sterile techniques. You know, one of the most important things that we know is keeping the lashes out of the way. Drape the lashes, get the lid speculum, keep them out of the field. We use a lot of single-use instruments. If not, we have thorough cleaning of instruments. Negative pressure ORs to try to help with that air. And then cleaning solutions, whether it's the patient's scrub or the surgeon's hand scrubs. Iodine is by far and away the most accepted, but chlorhexidine is also a close second. 99.99% killing rate, say, with iodine. And then we use prophylactic antibiotics, and there's some patient instructions that we use as well to try to reduce the risk. So wounds have been shown to be important. There's a lot of conflicting evidence as I reviewed the literature on this. Infratemporal wounds in right eyes, thought to be closer to the lid, had a higher risk in a Bascom-Palmer study. Definitely a wound leak post-op day one, 44 times the increased risk of endophthalmitis. There's some studies that showed clear corneal incisions had an increased risk, other studies that showed that it didn't. The thought is you get some egress of fluid with post-op manipulation, you get hypotony. Those wounds can open up a little bit easier maybe than scleral wounds that are covered by conjunctiva. In Sweden, they showed that there really wasn't a lot of difference between clear cornea and sclera. I think the jury's still out on smaller incisions. There's not a lot of published data. They do, yep. They are using all intracamerals. Smaller and smaller incisions out there. One of the advocations for that is less endophthalmitis, but there's not a lot of good published data on that. And I think everyone understands that you should put a suture in if you don't have a watertight wound at the end of the case. That's the biggest deal, is making sure that your wounds are watertight. So what do we tell patients? People are different on this. You know, some people put patches, some people put shields, others don't. There was a study that showed that there wasn't a lot of difference between patching or shielding patients. No swimming or showering up to a week, heavy lifting. Everyone kind of has different ways or different preferences on what they say. I tried to tell a patient not to lift anything heavy at their job for a few days, and Dr. Tabin rebuked me. He just doesn't believe in it. People just have different practice patterns on how they do this. So it's just a patient instructions is a big area where we don't know for sure. But for sure, you know, dirty hands rubbing your eyes is probably not a good thing. So prophylaxis. There was a study in 2002 where they looked at all the different types of prophylaxis, and the only one that was shown to have moderately important outcomes clinically was iodine. None of the other ones showed any importance. So they looked at all these different ones, and the only recommendation was a recommendation of a B on this iodine. But lash trimming, irrigating the surface, antibiotics, irrigating solutions with antibiotics, heparin, lots of different things just didn't seem to help. So what are the different types of prophylaxis? By and large, the most commonly used is just topical antibiotics. There's differences in practice whether you use them before surgery, around surgery, and after surgery. Most people use them after surgery, but that's not universal. Not everybody uses antibiotics the same day of surgery, as I looked at the literature. And there isn't a lot of people who use them before in the literature, but again, it's just there's a broad range of different practice patterns. Intracameral, again, this is off-label, completely off-label, so it's important to understand the risks of that. But we'll talk about the evidence behind that. These are the different antibiotics that are used in that. Subconjunctival, in some areas of the world, that's just what they do. They just inject antibiotics under the conj at the end of the case. There's some places that use oral and even IV moxifloxacin around the time of the surgery. And then there's some that are putting antibiotics into irrigating solutions. So those are different ways that we can use antibiotics prophylactically. So let's look at some of these antibiotics. The fourth generation fluoroquinolones are probably the most broadly used here in the United States. Gadifloxacin and moxifloxacin are the most common. Levofloxacin is what they used in the ESCRS study, not used a lot in the U.S. And bezifloxacin is a newer one. I don't see it used very often. The way it works is it blocks DNA gyrase and topoisomerase from forming, which are important in DNA replication. It really covers gram-negatives and gram-positives, pretty much everything on the spectrum that causes endophthalmitis. The only risk are the resistant bacteria for fluoroquinolones. Side effects, none of these are really side effects with local use. These are more systemic use, QT prolongation, tendon rupture, hepatotoxic. Alcon specifically labels moxifloxacin not for intraocular use. It's important to know if you're going to use this one. There was a rabbit study that checked anterior chamber and vitreous samples after injection of moxifloxacin, and it showed that you had a good MIC of really all the pathogens for up to 2.5 hours after injection. And they checked corneas, and they didn't find any toxicity in the corneas of these rabbits. There was another study that showed intracameral. There aren't a lot of studies on moxifloxacin, but these are small studies, 2,600 eyes. You only have 1,000 and 1,300 eyes. No intracameral moxifloxacin, one endophthalmitis event, zero in the group with intracameral. But again, these numbers are too small. Yeah, there's none in the literature that have enough to really tell if moxifloxacin is good. There are some studies that show that it's safe up to 150 micrograms per ml in concentrations within the eye. and all you need is up to 2.5 micrograms per ml to get above the concentrations needed to kill most bacteria within the eye. This is the scary article that I found, is the resistance patterns with coag-negative staph and ophthalmitis to all of the fluoroquinolones. And you're getting up to almost half of bacteria that are causing ophthalmitis that are resistant to fluoroquinolones. And that's definitely gotten worse over the last decade or so, two decades. So what about cephalosporins? This is the most common one used in Europe, cefuroxime and cefazolin. So these are against cell walls, they're beta-lactamase antibiotics. They work against gram-positive and gram-negative. The one gap of coverage is enterococcus, which can be a really bad infectious organism for endophthalmitis. There is the penicillin cross-reactivity. Historically, it was thought to be 10%, but in allergies, it's really felt to be more like 1% of patients who are allergic to penicillin will have this. There are some cases of anaphylaxis in the literature after intracameral cefuroxime injections. About vancomycin. So there's a few studies on vancomycin that are out there. The way that it works is it blocks cell wall synthesis as well. This is the key to it. It only works against gram-positive. There's no gram-negative coverage. But by and large, it kills any MRSA bacteria. There's a little bit of resistance, but not much out there at all. This is the key to it for me, is the CDC has put out an advisory saying we do not recommend using vancomycin for endophthalmitis prophylaxis. And their fear is that resistance pattern that's occurred with fluoroquinolones will happen with really our strongest antibiotic against MRSA. Another study with serial taps using vancomycin, it showed that it stayed at a good concentration for more than a day against all the bacteria that can cause infections as far as gram-positives. Some of the studies that are out there, 0%, no endophthalmitis in 19,000 cases using intracameral vancomycin. Another study in Asia where the rate's 0.01% in 94,000 eyes using vancomycin. So it appears to be very effective. But again, the advisory by the CDC is something to keep in mind. So what do we know about the use of antibiotics in Europe? Or here in the United States, only about a quarter of people were using them in 2007. Most said that they would use them if there were some available commercially. They didn't want to worry about the compounding effects or problems. In the UK, about half of people were using it. In Europe, it went from 60% in 2010 up to 75% in 2014. Most are using cefuroxime there. Looking back at our patient, she's 2 months now after presenting with endophthalmitis. She has a visual acuity of 20/80. Her eye is pretty quiet. She just has a lot of vitreous debris and has plans to have vitrectomy to get that cleared out to help her with her visual recovery. This was a tough hike. The lower, middle, and upper emerald pools, we planned to go to the lower because it was a paved trail, and then we thought, heck, let's go. So we picked up our kids and went up to the upper ones. It was a lot of fun. It's scary hiking with kids in Zion, but you can do it, even with four. We had two in backpacks, and then the two younger ones hiked. So this is probably the biggest study out there. That's the best data, at least. It's a prospective randomized study of 16,000 patients where they had intracameral cefuroxime, and they compared that with just topical prophylaxis, but they used levofloxacin, which is one of the big downsides to their study. So they found that the rate in intracameral cefuroxime was 0.07%, and then topical levofloxacin was 0.3%, which is a pretty high baseline rate to be comparing it to. And so they showed this 5.8-fold reduction, which was, you know, big news. But again, I think this baseline is way too high to have a good comparison. They didn't use the fourth-generation fluoroquinolones like we use now. In Spain, good study out of Spain with cefuroxime, 19,000 patients. They had a total of 44 cases of endophthalmitis with an overall rate of 0.2, again, a pretty high rate. Most were these gram-positives. They found that the number needed to treat to prevent an endophthalmitis infection with intracameral cefuroxime was 182 patients. So that's how many you had to treat to prevent it. This is one of the biggest issues, is these negative culture ones that make it kind of difficult. They kind of skew the numbers pretty bad, but most of them are coag-negative staph on the culture positive. This is their graph from before introduction of intracameral cefuroxime to after. You can see a huge drop in the rate in their cohorts. It showed just the relative risk is 0.06 if you use intracameral cefuroxime versus not. So a pretty big risk reduction, 0.93. They looked a little bit at the cost analysis there in Spain. It only cost them €1 to use cefuroxime. The cost of enophthalmitis for them is about $1,300. And so you'd save $1,178 or euros for every 182 patients you treat. In the US, the cost is about $1,400 for every case of enophthalmitis. And they compared the cost of fluoroquinolones, just topical fluoroquinolones versus cefuroxime. Fluoroquinolones would have to be 19 times as effective as cefuroxime to balance out the cost differential just because of the expense of fluoroquinolones. This is a good study out of Canada. So they looked at their practice over 8 years and they tried to identify different things that were more risky for endophthalmitis. So they had 75,000 cases. Overall, their rate's very low. It's 0.03%. They didn't find any effect with intracameral or subconj antibiotics. They definitely saw that using fourth generation fluoroquinolones topically lowered the odds. And then if you put in a drop of timolol at the end of the case, increased your odds of enophthalmitis. So these are the different things that they do in their practice. Half of the doctors use pre-op antibiotics. Most use same day. Not very many of them are using intracameral, and if they do, it's vancomycin. Some are using subconj, cephalosporins. Some are using steroids, most of them actually. And then these glaucoma drops, the timolol enophthalmitis rate for them was 0.2% compared to their overall rate of 0.03. So a pretty significant increased risk with using topical timolol at the end of the case. No difference. It's tough. They're retrospective.
What is the coexisting reason? I mean, they got a correlate. It could be you've got a person who has a very high rate,
Right. Yeah. So they found that a temporal incision was more riskier than a superior incision, and then their wound types didn't have any difference in their population studies.
There's other big studies out that show superior more risky than temporal.
Yeah. There were, when I started the literature search on this, there were well over 100 articles on it. It was a big review. So the different types of antibiotics that they use after the case, if you see, polymyxin B just was not very good for them. That was the only one that had significance, having a higher rate if that was used for prophylaxis compared to the others. Tanzania threw out a little letter in JSCRS that showed they initiated intracameral cefuroxime in 2003 and they've had 0 cases of enophthalmitis since. Before that, they were having 1 a month, so they were having a pretty high rate. Their surgical volume is about 7,000 cases a year. Moshafar and Vitali published a paper from here. They looked at 9 centers in 7 states, more than 20,000 patients. The rate using topical fluoroquinolones was about 0.07%. And moxifloxacin was a little bit worse compared to gadifloxacin, but not statistically different. So what about the Swedes? They seem to have the lowest rate of endophthalmitis reported out there. Almost 500,000 cases, their rate is 0.029%. It's felt to be unethical in Sweden to not use intracameral cefuroxime, so it's pretty widespread there, and they do not use any topical antibiotics. They only use the intracameral. I was going to go through all these different things, but I'm going to skip this. This just goes over all the different rates. Just to point it out, the endophthalmitis rate without intracameral antibiotics was about 0.3 in all of these studies combined, and with intracameral is about 0.05. So they showed kind of a big difference between the two. So if you're going to use the intracameral antibiotics, these are different doses that you use. Moxifloxacin does not need to be compounded. You can just use the bottle. It's self-preserved, and most people are injecting about 0.5 up to 1 ml. 0.5 ml. That is the bottle that Alcon says not to use. That's really the only way that it's available. Vancomycin and cefuroxime, it's a milligram per 0.1 ml. And then cefazolin is 2.5 per 0.1 ml. So you can compound any of those into that dose. So what are the problems? We had the big Avastin outbreak of strep in Florida in 2012. There's concentration issues. There's a couple of reports, you know, you had 50 to 100 times the recommended dose and 40 to 50 milligrams of cefuroxime. This study actually, they had pretty bad outcomes. Half the eyes had pretty poor vision afterwards.
Yeah, definitely.
These cases actually turned out okay. These six cases, they had pretty good visual outcomes. And, you know, this hit the news a couple years ago with the big meningitis outbreak with epidural steroids. So it's a big problem with just the stigma that's out there on compounding pharmacies, and you're definitely at a huge risk by using compounding pharmacies based on some of the outcomes of these studies. TAS is a huge deal. If you want to avoid TAS, you've got to have the preservative-free, you have to have proper concentration, you have to have the pH, all of the different things have to be in good balance in order for that to be prevented. Looking forward at some of the different ways that people are thinking about prophylaxis, there's Japan is looking at antibiotic delivery using IOLs. And they basically put antibiotic on the IOL, on the surface of it, to have that kind of always in there for a longer period of time. In Brazil, they're looking at time-release subconj, ciprofloxacin, triamcinolone, alone. Rather than just putting that depot in right after the case, they're trying to have a time release over about a month. And then modifying IOLs to reduce any adherence of bacteria as well. So there are different ways that they're doing this. So what's commercially available if you wanted to get one of these products? There actually is now a commercially available cefuroxime single unit dose that's not preserved, it's preservative free, that can be used for this rather than using a compounding pharmacy.
Available in Europe.
Not here, yeah.
Not
here.
Very important.
Yep, can't get any of it here. Moxifloxacin, again, you can just use the bottle. Alcon has that label on it. And then you have to compound these three antibiotics. So I think there's some good evidence that intracameral antibiotics do decrease the incidence of enophthalmitis. I think one of the biggest problems with most of the studies that I saw is that their baseline rates were quite high. And what they were able to get to wasn't a whole lot different from just using topical fluoroquinolones from a lot of the studies that are out there from the United States. You have to watch out for compounding issues. And this puts you at big legal risk. You're using an off-label medication. There's not a lot of protection for you. Without good informed consent with your patients. The CDC, again, they advise against the use of vancomycin, so that's another arrow in the opposite defendant's quiver. And maybe it's the combination of prophylaxis, which is sort of what we use now. You know, we use iodine and we use topical fluoroquinolones. Maybe throwing in that intracameral cefuroxime to help with some of those gram negatives and gram positives is the best way to go. But I think the jury is still out. So the question is, what will you do? Does this change your practice? I like this number, 0.029%. I like some of the numbers that have 0%, but 0.01% in vancomycin. But using cefuroxime seems like a pretty good, safe way to do it, getting your rates down to 0.02%. I'm not ready to use vancomycin given the CDC recommendations and different things. Jim? So in the studies in Sweden, the cases of culture-proven endophthalmitis, I think 12 out of 13 in their big study were resistant to cefuroxime. They didn't have any cases that were susceptible to cefuroxime that caused endophthalmitis. Beyond that, there weren't a lot of great ones for intracameral use. Absolutely, you saw the pattern with fluoroquinolones. So, yeah, Dr. Mamos?
Well, I think it's a really nice review. You know, the data as we go further and further along is pretty compelling. You look at the camera antibiotics, you know, deep appreciation and optimize. The Swedish data is very good. The data out of Kaiser and California shows the same thing. You know, the ESCRS study that they did, which is the main one that started this, has a lot of difficulties with it. In the control group, they weren't getting antibiotic topically for a day. And they still bristle on Americans, you know, question that. Their rate of endophthalmitis with intracameral is about the same as ours in the fourth generation global and topically. Their control group is 5 times
Yeah.
So that was the reason. But now there's really good careful data on screening and follow up every patient with any of the registry. The intracamo is probably good. And for reasons that you get rid of issues with patient compliance, patient not picking up the drug, not putting it in, et cetera. And the question is kept your oxygen with the proper medication to use, or should you use something else? The reluctance of Americans to do this is because there's no single use, you know, sterile antibiotic available on the counter, nor will there be unless the FDA changes. Because in order to get a study that shows cephalosporin is decreased by any antibiotic, you'd have to have 100,000 people in the cost, or more, and the cost is prohibitive. And so you're just not going to see it happen. So I don't know if you guys realize every antibiotic post-op is off-label. There's no study in the U.S. that would show up that any antibiotic. There's no FDA-approved use of an antibiotic post-op prevention of antibiotics. So until we get a single-use injectable, you know, that we can do, this is going to be difficult. Because if you're going to use ceftriaxone, there's a complicated three-step process to do that. And there have been studies we've looked at all over the world where they screwed it up at 10 to 100-fold increase in the drug attacks. We've seen issues with TAS with vancomycin, we've seen improper use medications. I mean, you can take a bottle of Vigilox, not a particular thing, you go to 50% and inject it directly, and that's not causing toxicity. But we had one outbreak where the pharmacist said, hey, you can save money by using moxazin, which is cheaper, which is, you know, made for intravenous injection of moxiclus, for example. Preservatives and other things that have a huge outbreak from that, so they're very bad. So, if you're going to be compounding someone, you're relying on a nurse to mix it up, you're going to compound a pharmacy to mix it up, be very aware of what's going on.
Yeah, you get one outbreak of TAS, and it just ruined your entire hope of preventing vision loss.
So the latest Academy practice guideline that came out in cataract surgery, I was asked to be in charge all the one on prophylaxis for the ophthalmologist. And you talked about 100 papers. I said, well, just print them all out. And I got a stack of papers that I was briefing on. There are, I don't know, there's probably close to 1,000 papers.
Yeah, there's the good ones were 100.
Now, most of it is junk, mainly because there's not the power to detect. And you got to keep remembering that. If you've got an incidence of 1 in 2,000, and you have a, you know, and somebody's doing 800 patient studies, well, you're not going to have any power to detect. So in small numbers, even though they may be statistically significant, they're notoriously inaccurate when you know you didn't have the power to detect. All it takes is one crazy outbreak. But as we reviewed it, if you look at the overall information, there are some conclusions you can come to. So I think it's important to point out that one conclusion is, Nick, I think is absolutely correct, and looking at all the literature, I don't think anyone can doubt that there is a preponderance showing intracamo antibiotics are effective, in particular in areas of the world where infection is common. It's been very effective. The problem the United States has mentioned is its TAS, and you know, Nick and I were involved in a court case where one person, vancomycin, and they used the DSS plus additive, and all of them had bad TAS, and most of them ended up with a horrible result. It was a way worse result than endophthalmitis. A lot of people don't know, in the ESCRS study, they had a bad outbreak of TAS. Were you aware of that?
No.
I finally got Peter Berry out and heard about it. And I said, well, they said it wasn't too bad. And the guys came back. What they did there is they had some people who mixed it with sterile water. So, you know, and rather than using, you know, even sterile saline, which you probably suffered from sterile water, so you had, and you know that can be very bad. Alan Grant had a bad case of that, where somebody gave them sterile water so they were balanced also. Also, the cornea is going white before it's actually living. You re-inject the cornea to survive, but a lot of them are getting the damage. So, big issue. We can go on about that. Bilateral. If those of you who saw the AGO just had an article again. They keep talking about that simultaneous cataract surgery only has the risk of, like, individual eyes or individual vent. You can't have a similar risk in both eyes. Well, with TAS, 100% over and over again, and they had that already. fully regrade the patient and rest of the product that was caused by these issues. We agreed that intracameral, you just pointed out that a lot of people are going to moxifloxacin out of the bottle. The range of what they have to do as far as particulates and the way of other things is totally different for topical and intracameral. And if somebody gets in trouble with that, it's going to be something you can't prevent. So that's the big concern with doing that. It's going to happen eventually. It's a totally different process for a topical than it is for something that's being used.
Yeah.
But I think that all of those work. They work somewhat differently depending on the overall spectrum of where they are. But the key is getting enough antibody into the eye to likely be greater than the MIC and the bacteria that you're going to have. It's getting tougher with the MRSA. But frequent topical the day of surgery, have antibodies get in the eye. Ciprofloxacin, you showed that in the Brazilian study. If you're not looking at the literature to do that, cipro does not penetrate the eye.
Yeah, it's not
we
a good
already
one.
Had one study which we showed a highly significant difference with cipro, more likely to cause endophthalmitis than any of the other antibiotics. And if you look at it, its ability to, no one has shown that you can get significant MIC with cipro in the eye top of the ever. So cipro makes no sense. Subconjunctival, there's some good work done actually out of New Zealand, Australia, and they've shown that that also can be prevented. But I think it's pretty simple to understand. You can, the idea is you're contaminating the anterior chamber, and if you culture carefully within the surgery, 30 to 80% of the time, you're going to find there's some bacteria left inside of the anterior chamber. Having done studies with Nick and Lillian, I can tell you that the anterior chamber can generally handle a fair amount of particulates. But obviously enough that you're going to get an infection. So if you have something higher than the MIC inside the eye on the first day, you're likely to protect it. And that was our overall recommendation. I think defense-wise, and doing a lot of defense work in endophthalmitis, the one thing that would be hard to defend is if you didn't use antibody prophylaxis of any kind right after surgery, or you use something that's not likely to get into the eye unless it gets in a bad way. So ointment would be the case. Unless you patch it and put one of your patients get a whole ointment inside the eye, which is a very bad form to ask. But you just don't, you're not going to get any concentrations. Polymedicine, same thing. You're not going to get intraocular concentrations. I think you can easily defend that. Nick's right. You cannot put a study together. The one that we really pushed hard is Allergan, and they just did a cost analysis, and it's an impossible study. They came up with 250,000 patients. If they would have to prospectively enroll in two groups in order to make that, and prove that happens. You talked about the clear corneal. The one thing absolutely everybody has shown when we move from going scleral to clear cornea, the Medicare data showed there was a clear 3 times increase in the incidence of endophthalmitis in that early period. That seems to have largely disappeared. I think it was because there was a lot of leaky wounds that came left. And that 44 figure was the study that came out of RAM, media. There was a 44-fold increased risk of endophthalmitis. And we showed if you have a broken capsule or torn conduit, it was a 14-fold increased risk of endophthalmitis. So those are some very, very clear things. So right now, I think as long as you're getting a fourth generation in frequently the day of surgery, you're getting something subconjunctival, which most of us don't like to do. That hurts worse than the whole cataract system by far. But I think there's some pretty good studies that would certainly suggest that. And intracameral, and the heart of it then would be something that's not likely to get inside the eye. But you know, lots of fascinating stuff in this area. Just this 19,000 patient study. Let me just point out. That's our good friend Steve Arson, who has become, what would you say, Nick, messianic on this issue. That's associated with bilateral simultaneous surgery. This is self-reported by large groups. And we already know many of those people, we know those who've had it, who've seen cases of endophthalmitis. So his zero in 19,000 is not accurate.
Leave them out.
Him sending a letter out to people, well, how many cases you've done? Oh, I don't know. I've done 5,000. There's no big one record. I don't think I've had endophthalmitis, zero. study is it is not a study. This was just a group of people kind of giving their opinion of what they thought was ongoing. I think that in good hands, the incidents, you know, can be about where we are, 4 and 10,000. I think that's pretty reasonable. Taking completely zero, sadly, just knowing that you are going to occasionally get something in the eye.
Yeah.
A week after surgery, the reason why it's such a big risk is for corneal incisions that you can get a massive influx of tears in the eye in those circumstances. Where, you know, when Roger Harry and I were doing cataract surgery with our big surgery, it was not uncommon to see a little side L positive with your suture, but it was always flowing from the anterior chamber out. It was a micro leak, and they'd seal over a couple of days. It's where you get the tears inside of the eye. I'll just point out that there was a study quite a while ago, though, which they phage-typed the bacteria from endophthalmitis. So it's a very specific thing. There's a whole host of different viral infections you can get associated with bacteria. It's a better way of fingerprinting bacteria. It's very labor-intensive, but 90% of the phage-typed bacteria that got out of cases of endophthalmitis were the same phage type that you got on the surface. So there's no question the vast majority of this is coming from the surface. EBS, I think 68% is what you said.
Mm-hmm.
When they do the full phage type, they end up coming in over 90%. So that's where it comes from most of the time. And so the key things I think we need to do now is phosphine and iodide has become the standard. Evidence for that was a B minus. I'll just tell you, not positive. Covid and iodine are better. And then you need to use antibiotics. Preoperative antibiotics has really no good studies showing that it's effective. Decrease your bacterial load a little, but it's also been shown now, in particular, with studies done using antibiotics in association with intraocular injection, you dramatically change the flora and you get a big increase. And then either your camera or frequent use of the data, make sure that you're comfortable that incision is solid and sealed. If it isn't, it requires either a suture, a seizure, or probably even better, or something to do with film.
It's little glues that come out, yeah.
They're starting to come along. There's good stuff coming out, and I just put a new series of papers that are coming out and look at. And there's a whole bunch of stuff that's going to be at this new ASCRS being showing dramatically. That's important. And finally, we did a study. It didn't get published. It should have been published in a good journal, but for some reason it didn't. We actually looked at conjunctival cultures of the opposite eye on the day of surgery to see what the milieu looks like across the country. And I was PI of that study.
Hmm.
And our MRSA rate in Utah, 65. 65% of our staff species were, and all, essentially all of those, over 90% were highly resistant to fourth generation. So that's our standard MRSA for us, largely related to our culture.
Interesting.
Randy, a number of years ago,